corner for September. That means leaves are going to start turning. Means we lose our husbands every Saturday morning for football, every Sunday afternoon. Football season started. I got 3 nephews playing ball, so we'll see as much football as I can handle. About sixth grade through ninth grade. So, yeah, and so last night, a bunch of us were able to gather together and go see a pretty incredible movie called The Insanity of God. And so many things. First of all, I was so excited to be with my brothers and sisters in Christ outside the church walls. It made me think about how we just don't do that enough. I think that it's so amazing to get that excited and stand in a movie theater and talk about God. Like, that was pretty awesome just to be together outside the church walls. I hope that that's more of that stuff to come. I don't know. It we'll just try and start planning stuff just to do stuff. And whoever can come, and whoever can't. But it's going to be bonfire season, and it's going to be, you know, Michael and I are going to be moving to this side of town. So who knows? Who knows what will happen? Might have a furniture burning party in Waukee. We don't know. Sell the house first. bring your own hot dogs and marshmallows. But seriously, folks. But the movie, was about missionaries and fellow believers in Christ who live in the persecuted church. There is only one church, as we were reminded in the movie, the Church of Christ, the body of Christ. There isn't a persecuted church and a free church, but there are those who literally lay down their lives and offer a sacrifice of praise every single day and don't have the liberty and freedom that we have politically. And it was hard to watch, I think, and it was freeing to watch, I think. I don't know if there were a bunch of other you guys there, but at the end of the day, no matter what comes against us, the bottom line is Jesus enough? Is Jesus enough for whatever we're going through, for whatever we're facing, whatever our own battles are, whatever comes against us, is Jesus enough? And if we will allow him to be, he'll always be more than enough. But we have to give him that opportunity to be. And one of the things that I know personally struck home with me was, one of the believers said, you'll identify with the persecutor or the persecutee. And if we're not sharing the good news, we're hiding it. There's no in between. And, we're so worried about offense. And really, these people are being tortured and beaten. And, you know, in China, they don't even really trust you until you've been to jail. That's their seminary, is the jail in China. And the concept of being so isolated, the church being so isolated that they didn't even know if other people outside of China had heard about Jesus yet. They didn't even know. That's one thing they asked the missionary. Have other people in other parts of the world heard about Jesus? It gives me goosebumps. And they rejoiced when they found out that there are believers all over the world. And then he shared a story of persecution in Somalia for the Christians, his 4 Christian brothers that were murdered. And they wept. And they were up. They promised to get up. People who lived in such isolation promised to get up an hour a day earlier to pray for persecuted churches elsewhere that don't have the liberty and the freedom that they have. It was very eye-opening. And I think that the couple that kind of were the main missionaries that were, they were going into these places to see what help they could provide the persecuted church, what tools, what resources they could provide. And I think what they found is that churches are thriving. Those churches are thriving, you know, other than the religious stuff that they dealt with, their faith is solid. Their faith was not the issue. You know, the power of Jesus Christ was not the issue. It really was an issue of, are we doing enough? I mean, that's what I took away, is are we doing enough? And have I limited God and not allowed him to be more than enough? Have I not given him opportunities to show himself mighty? Have I been to a funeral and put my hand on the body in the casket? You know, have I stood in a grave? I heard a story about a believer that prayed for someone who had been chopped to bits and came back to life. I mean, do we really understand the power of the resurrection?
Come on.
the power that our God has put in us. Yes. We have been resurrected. Resurrected power flows through us. We are now Jesus Christ. And it's just so not about us. It's just not about us. When that man stood in the jail and he said, "Who are you?" He said, "I am the Son of the living God. I am Jesus Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." Can we really say that? I mean, like, there was such life given through seeing such persecution. There was such joy through understanding what this is really about and what it's really not. And I just feel like the timing of this movie was not an accident. The Lord is doing a work in the body of Christ all over the world, all over the nation, in our church, in our midst, in our city, in our... There's a stirring, and there's an invitation, just like the Lord always gives us. Will we allow him to be more than enough? And do we really, 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 do we believe? Does our life show the fruit of Jesus is enough? He is worth it. He's always worth it. He's always worth it in the end.
Getting this, but
So Michael and I have been in marriage counseling. Oh, he's setting up for this one. And the book we're reading is about setting healthy boundaries and about how setting boundaries and not owning other people's stuff is freeing for us, right? It sets us free from having to carry, to take on responsibility that's not ours. Just like we're not supposed to carry these burdens that they're supposed to give them to the Lord. I am no longer my burden. I am no longer my burden. And if I will just let myself go and give myself and give my life to the Lord, I don't have to worry about anything. Finances, health, where we're going to live, you know, how our, the state of our marriage, the state of our children, the grandchildren that we don't have. You don't have to worry about a thing because my life is His.
Right.
And I was just thinking about that when you were speaking, that setting those boundaries and setting us free, He's drawn the line in the sand.
Yeah.
And He said, I have finished the work.
Yeah.
I have finished the work. I have given you a new creation. You simply walk in my spirit.
Exactly.
You simply walk in all of the finished work. And when that Dimitri said, I am the son of, I mean, that was like a powerful moment in the movie.
Uh-huh.
Do we really identify? Can I look someone in the eye and say, I am Jesus Christ? Because that's what Paul said. He said, I don't want you to see me. I want to see you. I only want to see Christ in you. Is that, I mean, that's where we need to be.
Exactly.
That's where God is taking us. That's where God, that's how God sees us.
Right.
He sees Jesus. We know that. He sees Jesus. He doesn't look at the person bringing the offering. He looks at the offering.
Right.
You know, and I was thinking about Noah. Noah was the only man left before the flood. Was it because Noah was a good man? Was it because he was out without sin? No, because his blood was pure. That's the only reason. He hadn't mixed with the angels and the other beings of the earth. He had pure blood. That was it. The reason that we're okay, the reason that we're saved, the reason we have eternal life is because of the blood.
Right.
The blood of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. We are covered.
Right.
That's all that God will see.
Right.
It'd be like, because I know I say it over and over again, but He'll look at us. We'll try to talk to, and I feel like sometimes I pray and He looks at me like, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know who you're talking about.
Right.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
Right.
Makes no sense to Him.
Right.
Like, what are you talking about? Suzanne who? I see Jesus. Michael who? I see Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Like, He doesn't even understand the things that we're praying because we are not just seeing the situation. We're speaking. We see the mountain.
Right.
It's our job to speak to the mountain.
Yeah.
Right.
It's not our job to go tell Jesus about the mountain.
Right.
He's like, I have given you authority in the earth. He's not in the earth anymore except in us.
Right.
And I'm sure sometimes He just scratches his head going, well, then go speak to it.
Yeah.
And it will be laid low. Like, I know, how long have I been with you? And like, I like really makes sense. Like, how long, how many times have we read the scriptures?
Yes.
I shall say to this mountain, be thou removed and be cast
right.
into the sea.
Right.
Be thou removed.
Right.
You know, Satan, get thee behind me.
Right.
You know,
right.
Yeah, good stuff. Amen.
Yeah.
Yes, Jody. Yes.
So in this movie, then, the poor, I mean, just poor poverty, children are starving, you know? And so I feel like, yeah, Lord, your word, you know, it is alive. The things that we're speaking about, we are blessed. We really are blessed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, we have to get it so in us, like you said, that
mm-hmm.
no matter what, the things that we are battling, when we speak to them things, that word is giving, yes. Giving life to something that's dead, you know
mm-hmm.
what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or giving health to something that's broken, or love to something
yes.
that's hurting.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like God is asking simple questions to us, you know, like,
mm-hmm.
not that, I think He just, like you said, wants us to get this in us,
yeah.
that
mm-hmm.
it's just not about going to church.
Mm-hmm.
There
yeah.
is life in here, you know, it's life
mm-hmm.
in the workplace, life everywhere.
Yeah.
So I just encourage everybody, you know, it's not a mundane thing when you're speaking
no.
His word.
No.
His word is
when you were talking, I heard, I can't remember who sings it, Love is a Battlefield?
Mm-hmm. Pat Benatar.
Pat Benatar, yeah. Love is a battlefield. This world is a mission field, and love is the battle.
Yeah.
Like, people, what hurting people, they what do they want? They want love. They want acceptance.
Yeah.
We are created as human beings to be loved by the perfect one who is love. And when we're cut off, all we can think about is, I want love. I want love. I need love. And people are so unhealthy and lost and deceived that they can't receive it when it's standing and looking them in the face. And we forget we are the purveyors of love. We are the gift of love that God has to give to everybody around us. That is his light. That is the salt. That is the life. Is that love and that acceptance. And that love, it can heal a broken heart in an instant. It can. It opens blind eyes. It opens the deaf ears. It changes things.
Amen.
Amen.
When we speak the life in those people that are hurting, or that we think, you know, don't want it or whatever, we cause them to rise up to who they are.
Yes.
It's not our job to fix them.
Right.
We just speak it into them, and because it's life, it causes them to rise up to who they are, who God created them to be.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Anyone else? Anything to share? Yeah, James.
I've been seeing different things. Maybe God wants to change things at work. We get the manager, and all of a sudden this door director leaves. And we get this new guy from Cedar Rapids, and he's a drummer. Well, that might be a relating through that. But not only that, it might be changing the store for good. And I'm thinking about how much of an icon I could be to him. Are they really going to listen to him, or what am I supposed to do? And this is a challenge that we're dealing with every day. God is our director, and we just had to follow in his footsteps, in other words. And you're just, you know, and I said, well, maybe, you know, go to corporate, but get this new guy. And it's like, we got to relate to him. So I've been looking through and seeing what I can do better in the store. Other people don't do that. You know, they always tell you to examine your heart when you need, you know, you see what your strengths and weaknesses is, when it's in the life of Jesus, and, you know, and just... I just tell people that, you know, that God's here and that he's our light. You know, a lot of customers didn't bother me. It was so neat, you know, to sit there and I said, you know, that God lives through you guys, and, you know, and we pray. I see customers many a time. I'm thankful for the way I do it for 14 years. I know don't go into a whole lot, but it's just an expression of yourself and Jesus using others through us. That's what joy is. Others and yourself. And if we get through the joy of season, people need to remember that.
Amen.
Not the negative.
Amen. Yeah. Amen, James. Yeah, praise the Lord. Anyone else this morning? Any prayer requests or testimonies? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord. Invite him in here this morning. This evening. Not morning. Habits. Heavenly Father, we just come before you tonight. We just come to you with hearts full of love and adoration and appreciation, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your finished work, Lord. Thank you for making it so simple to trust you and believe you, Lord. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that lives in us, Lord, that renews our mind, Lord, that opens our eyes and our ears to hear and see the hurting, those that need to know you, Lord, those that need a touch from you, Lord, that need a word of encouragement from you, that need a hug from you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have poured your love out into us. You first loved us so that we might love you. Now let us turn and love each other, Lord. Love those all around us, Lord. That this world cries out, searching, seeking, desperate for your love. For your love, perfect love. That casts out fear, Lord. That sets the captives free. That opens the blind eyes. That opens the deaf ears. That helps the lame to walk. That heals the brokenhearted, Lord. And sets the captives free. Thank you, Lord, as you lead us and guide us into perfect liberty and freedom in you, Lord. Give us words of boldness, Lord, to speak forth. As you stir up the gifts, Lord, as the words of prophetic words, of words of wisdom, words of knowledge, Lord. Words of encouragement, Lord. The healing gifts, Lord. The teaching gifts, Lord. Stir up the gifts within us, Lord, to hunger and thirst to pour it out, Lord. As we know, as we pour out, Lord, you pour in. And as we pour out, Lord, you pour in. And that's how this river of God flows. And that's how it changes the land. And that's how mountains are removed. We speak to the mountains in this city, the mountains of religion, the mountains of fear, the mountains of doubt, the mountains of suicide in our youngsters, Lord. We speak to the mountains of complacency.
Yes, Lord.
And we say, be thou removed and be cast into the sea. Jesus. Have your way, Lord. Have your way in each of our hearts. Have your way in this house, in this service, in this body of Christ. Have your way in this city, Lord. Jesus, have your way in our world, Lord, this world that you created, that you formed, that you gave your life for before the foundations of the world, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your patience. Thank you, Lord, for your long-suffering. Thank you, Lord, that you don't give up on us, Lord, that you never leave us, you never forsake us, Lord, and that you lead us and guide us continually into more and more revelation, more and more revelation. And now is the time to walk out that revelation in wisdom, in practical matters, in daily life, Lord. That revelation isn't just for us, Lord, but to be shared, to be poured out and multiplied and to glorify your kingdom. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you've trusted us with these gifts. We thank you, Lord, that you've trusted us to use them for the glory of your kingdom, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you've called each one of us by name, chosen for such a time as this to be part of this body. Lord, as you knit us together, as you prepare to bring those in from the north and the south and the east and the west, Lord, as you're drawing them even now as we pray, Lord, make our hearts ready. Let your word be on the tip of our tongue, Lord. Let it be overflowing from our heart. As your Holy Spirit gives us the utterance, Lord, we don't need the understanding. We just need to speak it. For your spirit is alive. Your word is alive in our hearts. And when we speak your word, your living word, it is truth. It is life and it is light.
Yes, Lord.
Make the way, Lord. Make the way and we'll simply walk in it, trusting you, following after you as you lead us and guide us together. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. I feel like this is the first step of a beautiful journey. And he's saying, will you just take this step with me and trust that my word will be a lamp to your feet and that I will always lead you into victory. Always. But we have to be willing to take that step. Not knowing what comes after. Jesus, we trust you, Lord. We trust you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just a reminder, if you have your cell phone with you, to turn the ringer off or to turn it off. And let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law, therefore I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved.
The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Toby, you want to come take the offering tonight, please?
Once again, to hear your word, to iterate to ourselves, God, that it is faithful and true.
Yes.
Everything we take for granted, like you spoke light.
Yes.
We never doubt if it's going to be light the next day, God. We just know that your word is there doing what it was spoken to do.
Yes.
God, if we could just catch the vision, every single word you declare
is
faithful,
Lord,
and true.
Yes.
And it still has power and authority to accomplish what it is sent here to do. Let's get the vision and the grips of this, God, that burn it into our hearts,
Lord,
and we live by it. For we know you've declared it, therefore it is true and faithful. Now, Lord, we ask that you bless this offering, God. Bless the gift and the gifter. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. 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 Two things the Lord was showing me tonight. First of all, it ties into what Pastor John Kilpatrick was talking about last Friday night, that the difference between the anointing and the glory of the Lord is that the anointing is depending on man to be yielding through him and stuff. Mm-hmm. That it has its limits, but when the glory of the Lord shows up, it's all about him. Mm-hmm. And what I see is a situation of anointing.
God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence, for your tangible presence here tonight. Lord, we bless you and praise you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all of your goodness, for all of your grace, for your long suffering and patience. Thank you, Lord, that you never give up on us. Thank you, Lord, for showing yourself mighty on our behalf. We just bless you tonight, Lord, and ask you to continue to have your perfect will be done in our lives, in this service, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
amen.
The Lord.
Praise God. Praise God. God bless all of you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Mike and worship team. Thanks, Suzanne, for opening. Thanks, everybody, for sharing your testimonies and what the Lord has laid on your heart. Praise God. It's all good in Jesus. Amen. That's always exciting to me because everything I'm hearing, I've got the message I'm working on for Sunday is really about the word Jesus made flesh, how that translates to us, and how the glory is then revealed. It's kind of I've been still dealing with that from 2 weeks ago, and the Lord just continues to give me some things about that, so I want to share that with you Sunday. But for tonight, praise the Lord, I've got a short message, because it is Wednesday night. I try to cut back a little bit and still be faithful to what God's saying, but it is about the very things that we were talking about here tonight that you all have shared. So I appreciate the goodness of God, and I appreciate the Holy Spirit and how he does lead us and guide us. Even when we're not aware of it, he's still leading us. Praise the Lord. So let's get right to it tonight. Let's go to 1 John chapter 4, and I want to read a fairly lengthy portion of scripture here. So we're going to read 1 John chapter 4, 1 through 13. And I got quite a few scriptures here tonight, Mike, so the Lord bless you. And those digits, hallelujah. So, 1 John chapter 4, beginning at verse 1, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come. And even now already is it in the world. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. And let me just, that's okay, Mike, you can say that. You can go on to 13. But I'm just saying, this is exactly what we were just talking about. The only way this world's going to see God is in us. God is invisible. I mean, how we praise the Lord say that, yeah? But he can be visible through human beings, and that's what Jesus did. He brought the Spirit of God in human form so that people could witness the reality of God. And he's left us here for that same purpose, right? So hereby know we that we dwell in him and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. Praise the Lord. So Christianity isn't exciting because it's new or different, or because there's some new secret to uncover, although there are. It's exciting because it leads us continually back into the heart of what it really means to be human and made in the image of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, for they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. And so for those who really care about love, one of the most disappointing experiences in religion is when it becomes a man-made system.
Right.
A system of conformity, standardization, that we end up using to judge ourselves and each other. Conform yourselves to the right behaviors, at least externally, and you can pass as religious. Conform yourself to right behavior, and you can seem spiritual,
sure,
or even good.
Right.
Praise the Lord. This goes to what Suzanne was talking about. You know, just not accepting the baggage.
Yep.
Not yours or anybody else's.
Mm-hmm.
He's already taken it. It's already his. Amen. Mm-hmm. See, all the attention is focused on measuring ourselves by who has been less bad than us. Sometimes I've had to look a while, but I can always find somebody. I may have to go to the prison or the, you know, somewhere. But, you know, that's the way it ends up being. Somebody less good than I've been today, right?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of trying to reflect the grace and the love of Jesus.
Right.
It can be counterproductive to guard our moral status and make perfect righteousness our goal in terms of what we can produce. Amen? It's counterproductive. It just doesn't work. It just exhausts you and everybody around you. Amen?
Right.
So, certainly, this isn't the life that God's called us to.
No.
Just biblically speaking, that is not what this is about. Amen. In spite of what religion has tried to teach us and force down our throat. Amen. Let's look at Matthew 23, verse 23. Yeah, Matthew 23, verse 23. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, faith. These ought to have been done and not to leave the other undone. So he's not telling us that we shouldn't do those things, but he's saying the thing you should be focusing on, you're not focusing on. You're let me just read it from the Message Bible. You're hopeless, you religious scholars and Pharisees. Frauds. You keep meticulous accounts. You keep the books on tithing and every nickel and dime you get. But on the meat of God's law, things like fairness, compassion, commitment, absolute basics, you carelessly take it or leave it. Careful bookkeeping is commendable, but the basics are required. Do you have any idea how silly you look writing a life story that's wrong from start to finish, nitpicking over commas and semicolons? And I could read on, it just goes on and on, basically relating that same thing over and over and over. So what would happen if we flip the system? What if religion was primarily focused on doing the things that are never wrong, instead of avoiding the things that are always wrong? Does that make sense? How about if what Jesus is telling us is, how about if we just focus on the right and forget about the wrong? Praise the Lord. We spend all of our time worrying about the wrong thing we might do instead of the right thing that we can do. Christ has given us permission to flip this thing upside down. That's exactly what he was doing when he came into the world. He flipped the system.
Yes.
Now, we flipped it right back shortly afterwards because we were more comfortable with that. But,
yeah.
But nevertheless, that's what he came to do. And that's what he's trying to do in each one of us, even to this day. Look at this, Isaiah chapter 30 and verse 15. Here's a picture of salvation. For thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved. Yes. Not in returning and working your butt off, but in returning and in rest shall ye be saved. In quietness and in confidence, the very things you were talking about, right? Shall be your strength. Yes. But they wouldn't. And sadly, the vast majority of Christianity still hasn't come into the rest, into true confidence in what God has done and what God is capable of doing in each one of us. So if you can now, Mike, let's go back to Matthew again, Matthew 18, verses 21 and 22. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Seven times? And Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven, which basically means there's no limit to how much forgiveness we should give, because there's no limit to the forgiveness that God gives us. So instead of managing behavior, how about exercising faith? How many of you know it takes faith to do that? Because you're not getting any reward for it. I mean, if you have to keep doing it over and over, that's telling me something's not happening on the other end, right? But we still do. We still do. So instead of trying to manage behavior, just exercise faith.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, or 22 through 26. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. This is fruit of the Spirit that we all have. Meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Praise the Lord. So, what does he say? There's never a time when love is wrong. Never. Praise the Lord. Go back to verse 22 and 23 of Galatians 5. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. That all above. But the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Praise the Lord. So there's never a time, based on that scripture, when love isn't appropriate. Praise the Lord. Now, go to 1 Corinthians 13, and we're going to again read a lengthy portion of Scripture here, verse 1 through 13. Actually, this is a picture of God himself, but it's also relating to us because we have that Spirit, right? We already know that God is love, and this is kind of making it a little clearer to us how that manifests. So, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, because that's the translation, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. That's what Mike is talking about. We've all kind of talked about this somewhat, where, you know, you have people with giftings, but they're not operating according to the Word of God.
Come on.
Right. Now, it doesn't mean God will still respond,
right,
but that isn't the perfect will of God. Right. So we're still kind of hung up on the anointing. Which is absolutely what he said is absolutely true. Every single human being that's born again has the anointing.
Right.
They have all the anointing.
Yeah.
Right. If you have Christ in you, he is the anointed one.
Yes.
He is the anointed.
Yes.
He is the anointing.
Yes.
So if you have him, you got as much as anybody else. That's what the Lord told me when I went up to, I was running all over the country chasing one guy after another, ministry here, ministry there, trying to get someone to impart something to me and all that stuff. And I'm sitting in Minneapolis, Minnesota, listening to Rodney Howard Brown and trying to get, you know, somebody to impart something to me. And the Lord told me clearly as I've ever heard him, what has Rodney Howard Brown got that you don't have?
Come on.
And I thought, well, he's got a huge ministry. He's got this anointing. And the Lord said, the only thing he's got is me. And it's the same thing that you have. The only difference is he knows it and you don't.
Come on.
He's aware. People that are operating in the gifts, the only difference between them and you, if you're not operating in it, is they have an awareness of that that it's available to them. They're just acting out on what is already a reality to them. The problem, the reason we're not doing it is because we don't feel like we've got it. If you've got Christ, you've got all the anointing there is. There isn't any more anointing you can get than Jesus Christ. I mean, he's God in the flesh. He sent back his spirit. He went away so he could send back his spirit, which is the spirit of the anointed one, the spirit of God Almighty. I don't even know if God needs to be anointed. He's God, for crying out loud. Right? And now God is in us. So, you know, sometimes it becomes semantics. It's just language. It's just verbiage. You know, we're talking about stuff that we're not thinking about the reality of what it is we're saying. You have Christ in you. He said the greater one's in you.
Yes.
So we get all flustered and worried about this anointing, that anointing, getting this impartation. Man, I believe that that's a reality, but it's more about awakening the individual to what they already have than it is somebody giving them something that they don't have unless they're not saved. Sorry, but that's the way I feel about it. That's what I believe because I've been down this road.
Yes.
I've been there already and done that. And, man, I mean, I didn't get a T-shirt because I wouldn't wear it if I got it. Look, here's stupid, you know. It's like the fair, you know. I'm stupid or stupid's with me or whatever it is, you know, and then he's got the stupid shirt. But though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not charity, I'm become a sounding brass, a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, have not love, I am nothing. Now remember this because we're going to get to where we find out that faith works by love. Some of the problems that we have operating in faith isn't that we don't have an understanding of faith. We don't have an understanding of love.
That's exactly right.
Praise the Lord. So I have all faith so that I could move mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profits me nothing. Mm-hmm. Love suffers long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth it not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things.
Sorry.
Hiccup. Endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. Sorry about that. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love.
Amen.
Now, there's no law, there's no legislation, there's nothing against love. It's never wrong. Now, I know the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And he just told us about it.
Right.
Prophesying. Works of the Spirit. Gifts of the Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
But they're not always accurate.
Right.
Come on.
He says they'll even fail sometimes.
Right.
Why? Because they're not done in love.
Right.
It takes us back to the place where we were originally, where he says, measuring yourselves among yourselves, mm-hmm. judging your gifts against somebody else's gift, mm-hmm. it's not profitable. Because
right.
it creates envy. It creates frustration, anger, disappointment, all of those things. But if you're operating in love, he says, it'll never fail. It'll always produce a positive.
Yes.
Because it's injecting God into the situation.
Yes, it is.
How many of you know, and I don't mean to equate this in that way other than just to say it, there are all sorts of spirits that can produce, and we even know in the end times, the Antichrist is going to do all kinds of miraculous stuff.
Yep.
I mean, stuff that's going to blow people's minds. Yeah. The reason why some people are going to believe that he is the Antichrist or that he is the Christ
yeah.
is because of the miracles.
Yes.
Nothing wrong with miracles, but if they're not done in love, it's just an act.
Yep.
It's not anything that's going to last eternally.
Right.
It's about that individual. That's the spirit of Antichrist. Now, I'm sorry, but that's just the way it is. When it's all about me,
yeah.
it's not about Christ, it's Antichrist. It's about my gift, my anointing, my this and my that and all that kind of stuff. I'm not saying we shouldn't operate in it. I said if we're going to operate in it, let's operate in love, or else it's not valid.
Right.
You got a lot of really mean, nasty people that operate in the gifts.
Exactly.
I mean, sit down and try to have a conversation with them. They're so arrogant and,
yeah.
you know, got their nose so high in the air, if it rains, they'll drown.
That's right.
You know right away. That's why there's a contradiction. We go, well, how can this be?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. So, gifts can fail. People can fail.
Yep.
But love, God, can never fail.
That's right.
Jesus' strongest commands are focused on what to do, not what not to do. Did you hear me? Praise the Lord. His biggest issue wasn't in don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. His biggest issue was do this. Love. Bless. Take me to the world. He didn't sit down and say, and of course, while you're doing that, don't do this, don't do that, don't have one of those, don't go there, don't do this. That's what we have done
yeah.
because we don't want to do the right thing, so we just major on what we're not supposed to do rather than what
yes.
he tells us to do.
Lord. Yes.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Matthew 22 again, verse 37 through 40. I'm trying to simplify this,
yeah.
that this is all about just doing what you can do, and forget about what you can't do.
Mm-hmm. Matthew
37 through 40.
37.
Jesus saith unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment.
Mm-hmm.
And likewise, and he goes on to say, love your neighbor. Praise the Lord. Technology. Don't you love it? Second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law
yep.
and the prophets. Praise the Lord. So he didn't get into all the thou shalt nots. He just said, do this.
Yeah.
Do this and you will have done everything that needs to be done. Now I've had a lot of trouble with the thou shalt nots. This I think I can do. If I just focused on this instead of on the other, right? All right, Romans chapter 13, verse 8. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law.
Mm-hmm.
Love fulfills the law. Grace wins over legalism.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus spent a lot of time talking about what we should do. The things that are always right.
Mm-hmm.
Not playing defense all the time, but get on offense.
Yeah.
So we've spent most of our Christianity on defense.
Yes.
How many of you know defense will wear you out?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Because we're always trying to stop the negative, the thing we don't want. And Jesus is basically just saying, get on offense. Just do what you do. Just do the right thing, and you don't have to worry about it. The best defense is a good offense. Praise the Lord. You want to please God? Quit worrying about not doing this and not doing that and not having this and not that. Just love. Get on offense. Let God loose. God is love. Galatians chapter 5, verse 6. Jesus was always saying, suffer the little children to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of God. The childlike love is the priority, right? For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. So keeping the law or not keeping the law, keeping the rules or not keeping the rules, going through the rituals or not going through the rituals is not the important thing. But it's faith. Faith is what's important, and that works by love. Faith becomes operational through love. So the best example of love is childlike love because it doesn't have any demands on it. It's just innocent. It just loves. Which means faith is not beyond us. We struggle with faith. We want more faith. We think we need more faith. We all those kinds of things. But we can do this. We can be excited about being all in. Be excited about being confident that faith is never wrong. Because love is never wrong. You believe God for anything as long as it isn't contrary to His word. And having every reason to have confidence that it will come to pass. Why? Because God is love. And faith works by love. And it's the faith of Jesus Christ that we've been given by love.
Yes.
For God so loved.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Yes.
Faith doesn't require, you know, Mensa-like IQ. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be, encyclopedic in your knowledge.
Nope.
You don't have to have a PhD, good looks, great talent, or any other natural, you know, measure of value. Or credibility. You don't have to have any of that.
Nope.
Right.
Faith simply requires believing in love.
Yes.
Matthew 5, verse 14. This is where I get excited, praise the Lord, because you are the light of the world.
Yes.
A city that's set on a hill cannot be hid.
Hallelujah.
So there's an exciting assumption buried in that scripture right there. And that is, you are the light of the world. Not you can be or you might be someday or it's possible for you to be. He says you are. It's positive. It's a reality. Praise God. You can't be hid. I was talking to someone the other day, talking about all the flaws and everything else, and I said, you know, I've got a little plaque thing in there in my office that says, you know, nothing wrong with cracked vessels. They let out light.
Mm-hmm.
We're all cracked. We're all crackpots. You know, we're all messed up.
Yeah.
But it's our humanity that makes this possible for Christ to shine through us, for the light to be seen. And He says, can't help but be seen.
Nice.
You are the light.
Yes.
And that light cannot be hidden.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. So Philippians 2:15 says, we shine as lights in the world. Verse 13 of that same verse says, it's God in us that's doing it. And I'll come back to that in a minute. But what God has called us to do is something that He's made possible for us to do. So it's not like we have to, you know, go through a long training program. We just need to be.
Yes.
And He will. We say this with my granddaughter there all the time when I was watching Builder Bob or Bob the Builder. We can do it. We can do it. Praise the Lord. We can do it. We have the mandate. We have the authority from God. If we couldn't do it, he wouldn't say we already had it. He wouldn't say it was already a reality. You have gifts. You have talents. Everybody here has gifts. They've got talents and they've got ability. And they can love. So there's no limit to what you can do. Amen. You can raise the dead. You can cast out demons. You can set captives free. If you can't, then God's a liar. And if he's a liar, he's not God. Be empowered. Be encouraged. God, who has called us to love, has given us the capacity to love.
Yes, he
has. He doesn't call us to something that he doesn't empower us to do.
Right.
He gives us the capacity to love and calls us to do it so that faith can abound. So that God can be revealed. So that he can be seen, so that he is pleased.
Yep.
But we'll finish with this. Philippians chapter 2, 1 through 15. And this just kind of emphasizes what we've been talking about. Philippians 2, 1 through 15. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind. Let each esteem the other better than themselves. Isn't that what we were talking about? I don't want to see anything but Christ and him crucified. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, and let me just back up for just a minute, he said, you have the mind of Christ, Paul said, put on the mind of Christ. He says, you have it, but we don't necessarily put it on. We don't actually activate it. So let that mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, what we were saying earlier tonight, right?
Yes.
But made himself of no reputation. So even though you are Christ, you're not saying I'm Christ so that everybody can say, what a wonderful human being. This is him. This is the thing. This is it. No, we're just declaring that reality, that authority, and that power, and that anointing, amen, because we are Christ. Let that mind be in you. He says you've got to get that same kind of way of thinking if you're going to ever do what Jesus did. You cannot do it in some subculture of Christianity that has got you beat up and hiding in a corner somewhere all the time because you failed. About the things you weren't capable of doing. Forget about that. Focus on what you can do. Focus on what you do. Amen.
Yes.
And was made in the likeness of men, being found in a fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and of things in earth and things under the earth. Every devil has got to respond to Jesus.
Yes.
Amen. And you are Christ in this world. So you know what your priority should be, right? And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. We talked about that a little bit Sunday, but that's what we're talking about. We're not talking about work out your, you know, whether you're going to heaven or going to hell. We're talking about working out the completed work of Christ in your life. That's salvation. It's everything. It's healing. It's deliverance. It's all of that kind of stuff. And we're seeking after a healing ministry. Why? You have the healer.
Yes.
You don't need a healing ministry. You have the healer.
Yes.
Right? You don't need to go seeking after prosperity. You have the prosperity in you.
Yes.
You don't need to go looking for a deliverer. The deliverer is in you. You are the deliverer. Amen. You are the means by which people are delivered, including yourself. For it's God which worketh in you. Right? It's God that's working in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. What pleases God? Faith. How does faith work? By love. Do all things without murmuring and disputing, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Why do we shine? Because of what he just got through telling us.
Right.
It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's God that's in you working out his pleasure, working out his purposes through you. How can you not shine if it's God that's in you doing this?
Right.
Amen. The only difference, or the big difference between Jesus in terms of his being a human filled with the fullness of the Godhead and us, is that he knew it.
Exactly.
He knew it. He found himself in the scriptures. That's what he says in Luke chapter 4, and that's what he where he quotes from Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me. How did he know that? He found it in the book. It says he found that in the Bible.
Yes.
And then he told everybody. And what happened? They all got mad.
Yeah.
I promise you, you present this to an unbeliever, to someone who's lost, who's looking for the answer, and they'll open their arms up to that kind of love, to that kind of acceptance. Share the same thing with a lot of Christianity, and you'll get slapped down right on the spot, get thrown out of the church and humiliated and everything else. Why? He just told us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Christ is in us. God is in us. Love is in us. You cannot be a Christian and not have the capacity to love. Now, you may not love, but that doesn't mean you don't have the ability to do it. So instead of us focusing on the thou shalt nots, how about we just focus on the thus saith the Lord. Do this. Love.
Yes.
I just challenge you tonight, and I'm done, but I just challenge you tonight. Just forget about all the thou shalt nots. Just put them out of your mind and focus on one thing, loving.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see faith rise,
mm-hmm.
and you'll see God revealed. It has to happen because God is love and faith works by love. That's why God can just say light, and it is, and it still is. In fact, light continues to expand at 144,000 miles per second or whatever it is for the speed of light. It continues to this very day. The universe expands. It's still expanding because he said it and he never took it back. It's still happening.
Yes.
It's still ongoing. Everything that God says, as Toby said, everything that God says, it will not come back void.
Right.
If it can find soil, if it can find a place to go, it's going to produce.
Yep.
Amen. It can't do anything else.
Right.
So imagine if you didn't have throughout your day, you didn't have thoughts of how you failed this one, or you didn't do that one perfectly right, or you had this attitude, or you were upset with somebody, or this thing, or that thing, or the other thing, or yourself. Imagine you just took all that out. Now you're free to love. Amen? Your love is worth something.
Yeah.
It's the power by which faith moves. Faith moves mountains.
Yeah.
Amen? But you can want the mountain to move all you want with a hateful attitude, and nothing's going to happen except you're just going to get more and more frustrated.
Mm-hmm.
You have the ability to love because God is love and God is in you. He works in us
mm-hmm.
to produce
mm-hmm.
God things,
mm-hmm.
healing, deliverance, prosperity, all of that stuff.
Amen?
Amen? So how about we dumb this back down, flip the thing over, and do what Jesus intended for us to do in the first place. Forget about all the rules, all this craziness that the Sadducees and the Pharisees and everybody else that he says was just idiotic and hypocritical. He said, you, you, You're trying to define a life that you don't even know. You don't even understand. He came to give us life, and that more abundantly.
Amen.
Something that isn't a burden, that isn't a constant sense of regret and sorrow, but a sense of freedom, exhilaration, joy, power, authority, freedom.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. So I just encourage you, every time the thoughts come about the thou shalt not, just tell the devil to shut up.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm telling you, because Jesus said himself, he took away the weapon that the enemy had to use. What was it? He nailed it to the cross. It was the law, because Jesus fulfilled it.
Yes.
He fulfilled it. It no longer works against us.
Right.
The law has been fulfilled. There is no law for us,
right,
except the law of love. That's it. You cannot break a rule that doesn't exist.
Exactly.
I've said it thousands of times. If there's no speed limit out here, you can't get a ticket for speeding.
No.
Right. Amen? Right. Well, if there's no law, then you can't get berated by God or anybody else for breaking it. Because
right.
It doesn't exist.
Right.
Now, that's not so we can go out and just be complete lunatics, but it's to get our minds off of that and focus on the right thing. Amen? And I promise you, if you're operating in love, in faith, you won't worry about the law. The law will take care of itself.
Yeah.
The demands will be taken care of all by themselves.
Thank you, Lord.
Even though you're not under that demand.
Right.
People will see your good works. Amen. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm into Sunday already, but I'm just saying, those good works, he's not talking about you helping the old lady across the street, or changing the neighbor's tire or rocking the baby or giving money to charity or any of those things, which are all fine, but those are not what he's talking about. Good works are God works. Jesus said, you call me good, but he said, there's only one that's good. So he's trying to get him to say, yep, you're God, but they wouldn't do it. And so he's saying, they'll see your good works. They'll see your God works. And glorify your Father, which is in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
He, all of a sudden, he's become real through some human.
Yes.
Right.
Why? Because of love.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Give him one more hand tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. All right. God bless you all. Have a great rest of the week. Hope we'll see you Sunday. Love somebody. I mean, what I'm saying. Praise the Lord.